the honor roll call.
Thank you, John. And let me start out by welcoming all of you to the state's capital city. Share with you a little bit of the honest history. When the territorial legislature was meeting in Belmont, deciding upon a location for the state capitol, the textbook story is that they, in all their wisdom, selected this beautiful site on the recommendation of Judge Doty, who provided more than adequate land for a state university as well as for the location of the state capitol. All of that is true. Well, oftentimes, unfortunately, because we really want truth in our history, is that he basically bribed them. Most of those meeting at Belmont walked away with not only their decision, but with the title to hundreds of acres of land for themselves, and it was a wise business decision. My personal experience in passenger rail really predates my own memory. By the time I was 12 years old, I had frequently taken the Illinois Central from Chicago to the Indiana Dunes, the Penn Central from Chicago to New York, and frequent rides, obviously, on Chicago's L system. And in fact, the summer of 1957, I was attending Hyde Park High School summer session, which started early in the morning, finished at noon. And then Fred and Steve would meet me, and we'd walk the one block to 63rd and Stony Island, and probably at least twice a week, these 12 and 13-year-old boys would grab the L and go to either a day game at Wrigley Field or Comiskey Park. Obviously, we couldn't have done it without rail. By the time I became a undergraduate here in 1962, I was regularly taking the train back and forth between here and Chicago. But I mention this because as I reflect back on the decision to locate Millard Park in its suburban location in Milwaukee, there were some of us who were pushing for a downtown site. By the time that decision had been made, we'd already seen the examples of not only using rail to get to the older ballparks like the two in Chicago or Yankee Stadium, but some of the newer parks. One in particular where I had my own experience using rail was Camden Yards in Baltimore. And so when the decision was made, or was being deliberated, some of us put pencil to paper and came to realize that if the Milwaukee Brewers could attract in proportion as many riders to their ball games that were going to the games in Chicago, White Sox games at what's then called Cellular Field or at Wrigley Field, the proposed Milwaukee rail system would have one-third of all the passengers they needed to meet projections for annual ridership. Just going to and from ball games. But no, the decision was made to put it on the old site of County Stadium, in part strictly driven by the audience. Because to make the economics work for the revenues projected for the Brewers Brewer Stadium, the parking is configured the way it is, and it's so isolated that if anyone wants to drive to a Brewer game, it is a real hike to get from non-Brewer parking to the stadium. Well, that was the consideration in terms of the Brewers and Major League Baseball. But what was not considered was the rest of us. What was the impact, what would be the impact in regards to rail? Nowadays, like so many of you, I'll ride from an airport to the city, where there's an old system like Ford, Boston, Brewer system, like Seattle, or Portland. Or if I'm moving up and down the East Coast, take rail from New York to Washington, Sacramento down to San Francisco, and all that. But as we make these decisions, just as is reflected within the decisions on the Milwaukee Brewers, there's two things that have to come to mind. The first is the integration of transportation with land use. And the second is the interdependence of different modes of transportation upon one another. Now, some of them occur naturally. When rail first started blossoming in this country for passengers in urban areas, whether it was interurban or inner city, it was natural to taxi cabs to line up at the station and to take passengers to perform that last mile. But when we look at it in regards to modern day transportation needs, we should first reflect and think about it in terms of the centuries. Think about it in terms of thousands of years. One, it was not the automobile, but it was rail that opened up American suburbs. It was rail that took commuters from the heart of Chicago to the North Shore. It was rail, pre-World War II, that took commuters from Manhattan and back and forth to Long Island and Connecticut. It was not the automobile. But after the war, with the advent of the automobile, and particularly the interstate system, we saw hundreds of millions of acres of land consumed by the automobile. Land that could be put to otherwise productive use, and we won't go into the question of carbon footprints now. That's a whole other subject. But what I want to make is the point as to what happens when you convert a passenger from one system to another. And I want to use the bus strike and the bus system here in Madison as an example. By 1972, the city had committed to acquiring the private Madison Bus Company and turning it into what is now Madison Metro. At that time, cab drivers were opposed to the city's involvement in the expansion of the system. Their fear was that with greater utilization, greater ridership of buses, the taxi cab service would suffer. The exact opposite happened. Then, a few years later, almost 8 years later, when the bus system was subject to a couple-month strike after I left office, the general belief was that taxi cab service would benefit. It did for a short period of time, but it took over a decade for the bus ridership to recover and then potentially for the cab ridership. Why? It's really very simple. If you provide a sound public transit system, people are going to do away with the private automobile. They now become dependent on other forms of service. And so they will now not only ride the bus, but they will also take taxis. If they can't depend on one of those two, they're going to give up on both. Because once they make the investment in the automobile, they're going to not had the opportunity for frequent meetings with the U.S. Department of Transportation officials over the last year. And let me just say this, that despite what has happened in terms of the national message, there are still good people working in the U.S. Department of Transportation. They've at least lasted the last 10 months and hopefully longer. And there will be a day that we can renew conversations with them about infrastructure of this nation and an infrastructure that's based not on paving thousands and thousands of acres with the natural concrete, but with laying of rails. Here locally in Madison, in our own department, we still play with some ideas and look forward, and I am convinced that one day it will happen, that there will be what we refer to as the why. If you think of the three parts of the why, the one is getting to downtown, even though horizon, you don't see it happening in 2 or 3 or 4 years, that in our planning we include these kinds of transportation solutions for the Madison of the future. And obviously the same thing needs to be done on the state level. And so, for the prospects I'm meeting, I do think there's two things we can do to address these two issues, that issue of collaboration of land use and the issue of multimodal. One is in our planning, we have to continue to be consistent and demanding in regards to the future of rail. And then secondly, as we get engaged in discussions of sustainability, discussions of future transportation modes, make the point and do not leave people thinking that simply going to single occupancy, autonomous electric vehicles is going to solve a transportation problem. And lastly, one final thought, which is the fun of rail. And I imagine that most people in this room enjoy sitting alongside the window of a train and watching America roll by, whether it's here in Wisconsin or in California or on the East Coast or any of the viewpoints that angular distance.
Financing all this, but I'd like to refer to an article in the New York Times a few months ago about the Minneapolis-St. Paul light rail system. And the increase in property taxes for the building along that system in 4 years paid for the system, just the increase in property taxes. Secondly, it seems to me that Madison, I'm a newcomer here basically, has a real opportunity. It has a company out south called Epic with 10,000 people employed there who are all young. Aren't much into cars, but really need transportation. That seems to me to be an enormous driver for a starting system.
Well, the observation you made about the Twin Cities is actually really quite ancient. In terms of rail, we saw that when the metro system was put in Washington, D.C. back in the 70s, the increase in value of land just around the stations basically paid for the system. And that really has been the history of rail in this country since the middle of the 19th century. The problem is the lack of visionaries in critical positions, mostly in federal and state governments, who talk a good game about capitalism in the private sector, but don't understand the nature and the value of that investment and what it does. We're well aware of it. Like I said, I've been hearing these arguments that we could see as well as the arts. By the way, in New York City, about 5 years ago, an organization which was a comparable, New York City doesn't have a chamber of commerce. It's got this organization of business leaders that was founded by David Rockefeller back in the 1960s. And this organization, this is an organization with Citicorp and all the big New York City-based corporations. This is not a bunch of flaming Madison liberals. Came up with a recommendation for the price differential, for the differentiation, basically keeping private automobiles outside of Manhattan, for which they needed authorization from the state legislature. And they actually seem to have momentum, and to really get this adopted so that New York City will be more dependent on public transit. By the way, there's no competition. Buses have nothing to compete with the efficiency of the ride I had from midtown. Soho. But in any case, they're in the roadblock. There's a specific industry that killed the project. And that is an industry that very fortunately does not exist here in Madison. That industry was the private parking ramp owners. Because they understood what this was going to do to their revenues. And that is, by the way, one of the reasons since my very first tenure as mayor, while we will allow parking associated with buildings, new offices, and with residences, we will not allow anyone to own independent freestanding parking ramp. Because we want to have free control, which would not sit well with the Koch brothers and some of their friends. But that's how we managed to control part of the